It's my pleasure to introduce you to Regents Professor David Boji from New Mexico State University. And when I've introduced him over the last few days, I've said titles and associated him with certain disciplines, and he said, no, not those things, I'm not that. So
I retitled the talk from Western Narrative to IWOC, which is Indigenous Ways of Knowing, Maori Living Story, I call it, and for caring for human extinction. In other words, the world's going to end, and we need to do something about it.
Oh, that actually worked.
Hey.
These are the mountains I look out from the back of my house that I live in. I got a little ranch with a few horses, two dogs, a cat. There's a lot of snakes. They're not mine. So the how of a person on the land, of a mountain, of a river, the vital essence or power. So I come from New Mexico. It's called the land of enchantment. And this is the Oregon mountain range. And this is the Kuru. If I pronounce the Maori names wrong, I apologize in advance. Just forgive me. Just forgive me now, right? It's really bad. But I love this heart-shaped spiral of silver. It just seemed like a really great image to me. Now, I'm from Trump land, okay? And there's a massive amount of economic anxiety. Unemployment is too high. Wages and incomes are too low. Millions of Americans are struggling. In fact, I met some Americans at the reception this morning, and they said, we were just trying to get out of the United States and come here to New Zealand, you know, take advantage of it. So people are jumping ship. And struggles for affordable health care. There's a gap between the rich and poor. We're going to go over that. And many of the people are physically exhausted because they work the longest hours of any industrialized country in the world. And we don't get any vacations, so I'm here. A little bit about where I come from, New Mexico. In the 51 states, we have the most child poverty. We have most unemployment. We don't tend to graduate high school students too well. We're 49th in overall poverty, 48th in high school degree graduation. 48 is bad, that's a bad number. Hunger insecurity, we have to feed a lot of the children when they go to school, or they can't stay awake in class. We've got a lot of teen pregnancies, very high, etc. A lot of homeless children, 44th in the nation. Just because we're the most industrialized country in the world doesn't mean we don't have poverty. United States or homeless. I work a lot with the homelessness situation. I want to talk today about moving away from Western narrative theory. So he was going to introduce me as a narrative person. No. I actually move against Western narrative for reasons that I'm going to show you. But there's a lot of work done now on narrative and counter-narrative approaches. And I'm going to start here with a quote from Gray and Milton. He's one of your professors here on accounting. I don't know, did he show up? Good, I can say anything I want. Good. He can't correct me. But he sent me, I said, send me some of your work. He sent me about 20 articles. I've been chewing through them. He said, we intend to offer a counter narrative to those accounts specific to species extinction that places humanity's ways of organizing at the core, recognizes that only fundamental reappraisal of Western humanity's current taken-for-granted narratives offers any bit of hope for biodiversity or sustainability. So what he's talking about there is that sustainability narratives are so bad that we need counter-narratives, because the narratives of sustainability legitimate us falling off the edge into human extinction. So, and he wrote this in an accounting journal. Yay. Anybody in accounting here? Nobody said one. All right, yay, for accounting. Okay, we'll get to marketing later. And sustainability will hasten humanity's extinction. That's sort of the theme. And that's why I don't want to be introduced as a management professor, because I think we're the ones hastening the extinction the most. And it seems we're intent on achieving this very aim through a destruction of the ecology with self-congratulatory accounts of human progress towards sustainability and greening and triple bottom line, et cetera, et cetera. So if you have any comment, just speak now. Okay, I'll go ahead. So if, and this is from Milne's article as well, human population in blue, extinctions in gold, I guess it is. As population went up with the Industrial Revolution, gained a lot more population, but we've also extinction to most of the species on the, not most of them, but quite a few of the species. So the idea is we're next. The cockroaches will survive, but we won't. Anyway, I'm a critical theorist, so if you wanted like an uplifting presentation, you should have got one of those humor people. Okay, so Western narrative, just a little background, I won't spend too much on it. Starts with Aristotle in particular. Said narrative requires story to be a whole. A whole is that which has a beginning, a middle, and an end. So it's a very linear rising action, climax, etc. So it's a linear narrative. Barbara Sinowska, some of the well-known people in narrative studies from Sweden, says narrative consists of a plot comprising causally related episodes that culminate in a solution to a problem. Very focused. Every narrative becomes new with each retelling, and the petrification of stories is not the result of myopia of the researcher, but of intense stabilizing work by the narrators and organizations. I'm not a fan of petrified narrative. I am a fan of Barbara Sinowska. I like Barbara very much. But the whole idea that we're going to reduce everybody's story to a petrified narrative so we can build strong corporate cultures, to me, is ridiculous. But I like Barbara. Carl Weick says, typically searching for a causal chain, the plot follows either the sequence of beginning, middle, end, or the sequence situation, a transformation situation. But sequence is the source of sense. Weick's sense-making narratives are retrospective. Carl's a good friend and was one of the people that actually read my work when I was a doctoral student and sent comments back. Wow. But I want to look at the forward, not the backward, at where we're going. Now, the way I want to do that is Western narrative needs to learn IWOK, indigenous ways of knowing. That's my premise. That's my thesis. And that's what I call living webs of relationship, community, and earth. Very good. A lot of Native American cultures, the turtle is the Mother Earth, you know, and we ride on the back of the turtle. This is my wife's book, Grace Ann Rozelle. Grace Ann, I'm plugging your book here. So. And Native Ways, Tribal Wisdom for Business Ethics. So it's sort of saying that we could learn a lot in the business college and university by looking at some ethical principles from indigenous ways of knowing. What I want to look at. Now, Western narrative can learn Tikanda. I don't know. How do you say it? Tikanda?
Tikanda.
Okay, close enough. So this means, you know, it's a figure eight. It's two people or two groups wedded together. But when it's this, got three loops twisted in it, you know, well, you all know what it is? Oh, good. I'll enlighten you. It's like cross-cultural, you know, relationships. least that's my learning of it. Indigenous wisdom is everyday living story practice. What is that? Let's get into it. Let's talk about it. So, get the tanka. That's my pronunciation. That's what it sounds like to a New Mexican. So the Maori philosophy is what I would call the heart of care, the heart of caring, and an obligation to implement care and protection of all forms of life, to look after and respect the Earth Mother and the Sun Father, is how I would translate it. One of you amazing scholars, Mason Dury, wrote this Taipei Mutanga, The Southern Cross, and I was very lost when I came here, and I bought a compass so I could find my way, and that's west. I'm in the east, you know? When I'm at home, I can see the mountains, and I know where I am, but here, when raining, I don't know where I am. And I have to feel grounded. Anyway, so he came up with the Southern Cross. And you know where the Southern Cross is? It's up above you. It never drops below the horizon. So he developed this understanding of autonomy, leadership, physical environment, cultural identity, participation in society, and healthy lifestyle. So you have the cross, Southern Cross, four stars there. You have two pointer stars that point to it. And you developed this model to get to a Maori understanding of the health systems in New Zealand. I thought it was brilliant, the way it's so grounded and so clear. You like it? I don't know. I like it. It's got stars in it. No, it's good. So, and this is health and socioeconomic well-being are inseparable as part of the theory. Was your socioeconomic situation, your health situation, are integrated. And his book, Nagatini Wayo, Navigating Maori Futures, the way I look at it is the huge scale of globalization, as technological change, as climate change, is producing a potential extinction event. And we're like the boiling lobster that doesn't know it's being boiled. By 2051, Maori population will almost double to close to 1 million, 22% of the total population, but 33% of all children will be Maori. I think by then you'll be able to get control of the legislature. That's what I'm predicting. I'm making a prediction here. And this is what the Southern Cross looks like, the four stars, the two pointers. And when you were navigating between islands, you could figure out this intersection here, and drop down and know that you're in the south. Or you could go between the two pointers directly to the Anchinar star and drop down and figure out where you are at all times. So it's really, really brilliant. Another one of his models I like in the health system is he combined the existing system had mental health, spiritual health, and physical health. And then the objective was to pull in family and community health and with it. So that's what this model did, and it became very popular, I understand, in New Zealand. When I'm looking around the websites on health, this is duplicated quite a bit. And it says, Te Wari Tapawa. That's how I say it. You could laugh at my pronunciation if you want. It's all right. But it's a nice model, and it means the four walls of the house. So you have to have a family wall, a physical wall, a spiritual wall, and a mental wall. So the Gregory Kehete, a Native American scholar that works with us in our annual conference, he wrote the book Native Science, and very concerned to have a spiritual ecology, spiritual understanding of the earth, and a community, focus on community. So this is highly important in what he's doing, what I believe in as well. Now that brings us to living story. and indigenous ways of knowing. Maori storytelling to share an enriched understanding. In the United States, we talk about re-indigenization, the need to Native American communities where people have moved to urban centers and they no longer know the language of the tribe and they don't know the rituals and customs anymore, many people, to re-indigenize is to relearn those customs, to relearn connections to earth, to relearn spiritual power, and make that something that I think will keep us from falling off the edge here. At least I'm hoping so. And there's a lot in Maori and a lot I'm reading in Native American about waves of colonization and how to peel back those waves. And globalization is part of that. And I spent a lot of time looking at Joe's Arawera's Maori storytelling. Now, living story, I can connect it up to Jacques Derrida's work. Each story is at once larger and smaller than itself, includes itself without including or comprehending itself, identifies with itself even as it remains utterly different. Now, if you don't follow that, you're not meant to. It wasn't meant to be written for understanding. You know, it's Derrida. Get over it. You know? But the idea is that the living story is always more, and you have to tell another one and another one and another one. You never tell this one to get to the understanding. That's why I consider it a web work, a living story, and part of a qualitative multiplicity. Now, you can get there through Mikhail Bakhtin's work on stories. So I'm trying to differentiate between Western narrative and people in Western that talk about story. So Mikhail Bakhtin, his dig was, narrative genres are always enclosed in a solid and unshakable monological framework. One logic, you know, one problem, beginning, middle, end, you know, a little bit too structured for indigenous ways of knowing. So he had the idea, how does one, what I call living story, lead to another, and yet another, and a whole web work of relationality. And I actually got the term living story from Caitlin Tutrees, a Lakota woman, scholar, really, really brilliant. Says, living stories have, David, a place where you tell them. They have a time when you tell them, and they have a mind. And so I don't understand what you just said. Well, I couldn't understand it because I was grew up in Western narrative, and that made no sense at all, why I would have to have a story in a place and a time. What does it mean if it has a mind of its own? Over several decades, I figured out that it meant, for me, that the story has an aliveness all its own in Native American indigenous culture, that story doesn't want to be told all the time. You know, you ever date anybody? Don't raise your hand. You know, but, you know, and you share those stories, you share, oh, these are the experiences I had. You know, and you're sharing those intimate stories. Well, you know, you don't know whether that living story wants to be told then. Have you got enough relationship foundation to do that? We'll move right along. There's something called dialogized story in Bakhtin. Dialogic imagination. So he's got a number of dialogic approaches. And so for him, stories are polyphonic, meaning they have many meanings, many points of view in the one story. So in Maori, what I'm hearing is they have many layers, and you peel back the layers to get to the deeper and deeper layer. This is from Milne Morgan and Kate Kern's work. Birch, they're all from New Zealand. And I really like this diagram. I'm glad we're filming this. I'm going to send this to Milne and Kate and have a comment on it. And it's the idea that you have increasing concerns for the environment quality, you have increasing concerns for well-being, and then you got all of these different approaches to sustainability. wandering through here. And some are about, ecological modernizers that are going to save everything with technology, the Bertrand Report, where you're trying to preserve the resources so your grandchildren have resources and you don't run out of them. But they left a couple out here off the diagram, so I'm going to add a couple. First of all, the triple bottom line, which they actually write about in the article. I'm going to talk about and deconstruct that next week, so I'm not going to go into it much now. But terrible theory, you know? So it's at this end of the spectrum. And then the Iowa, I think, is at this end of the spectrum. It's more about finding that relationship with social ecology, deep ecology, ecofeminism. They used to be really popular. Do you ever even hear the word anymore, ecofeminism? Hey, we do.
I'm teaching about that.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful person. Okay. This should not say anything. And Schumpeter, 1973, remember the book, Small is Beautiful? None of you remember that. You're not that old. Well, Chuck, Charles, and Chuck.
Thanks, Dave.
I'll just point you out. But he wrote the book that it's essentially the scale of the enterprises have gotten so huge and the economy so huge that we're not able to control the devastation of it's causing. So, in this quote from their article, the futurist perspective too seems consistent with these critiques. The abandonment of economic growth and the requirement of behavioral rather than technological change. There are elements in this perspective, however, that suggest change may be beyond human agency. Though we might have lost it where we no longer can clamp it down anymore. You know, there's some 40 multinational companies that have incomes greater than the income revenues of New Zealand, for example. You know, I mean, countries are not controlling this anymore. And it's beyond human agency and the ecological crisis in the United States. What did Trump do? He immediately put the fox in charge of the hen house, you know, get rid of the EPA, put an anti-EPA person in there, start dismantling everything, quit the Paris Accord, you know, on climate change. Climate change is a myth. Climate change is, you know, an opinion. Really? You know? How many thousand scientists are putting out scientific research on climate change and it's an opinion? So, but in the United States, it's an opinion. And you can get in trouble if you say it's not in my country. So when I say living stories, it's a living experience, still in the middle. It doesn't have an end. You can't even find the beginning. And it's just more small stories to small stories. And then you have dominant narratives and counter narratives. Big theme, a lot of special issues, new book coming out. Came out about it by Rutledge. And then I do this in the center. So it's called Auntie Narrative, A-N-T-E. Auntie means a bet, like ante up. Play cards, go to that casino, ante up. Or it means before. It's before narrative. So I'm interested in the stuff that's laying there before narrative, beneath narrative, between narrative and living story, and the becoming. And I call it forecare. This all comes from Heidegger's work, and so we'll just skip right over there, because that would be boring. This is my book that I'm best known for, and it starts with deconstruction and critiques of grand narratives, microstoria from the Italians, etc. When I got the contract to write the book, they told me, don't write anything new in that book. So why do you want a book that has nothing new in it? Well, because we only want the tried and true old methodologies of narrative in there. I said, that's ridiculous. You know, I felt a little bit, you know. So I did the book, And on purpose, I started with something really tough, deconstruction, and then I went off from there. And then when they were done looking at the book and the typesetters did their job, they sent me for the final revision where I could, you know, after they corrected all the grammar and stuff, I rewrote the whole book. And I put anti-narrative theory in every chapter. Something new. They didn't notice. It got published. And then it took like, I don't know, 15 years or something before, you know, Carl White came out and said, yeah, I think this anti-narrative stuff, there's something to that. Johns Gabriel and other stars in my field. So I was, hey, happy. But it took a long time for a new idea to come. You know what I mean? You don't know yet, but you're going to know. It's tough to get a new idea. So we're going to play a commercial. How many is in marketing? Okay. You're on the wrong side of the room. You're supposed to be. This is for you, the marketing. Okay, I don't know what button to push.
I don't know if that's going to work.
That sounds good.
No, that's... It hasn't got internet connection, so you just have to go into the...
Oh, we'll have technical difficulties for a minute. All right. So ask me questions now while they're searching for the marketing film. Ask me something. Do I have to call on you? You're awfully polite in this country. Okay, that's the end of the politeness.
What isn't narrative?
I think if you stick with an Aristotle definition or Barbara Sinowska or somewhat Giannis, you know, that this narrative has a structure, a plot, it has a beginning, middle, end, and it has a focus, and it's trying to achieve some demonstration of wholeness. But what it tends to do is dump all the living stories out.
And we don't need those.
We're trying to get a universal understanding here. So to me, that's not, when I go into the IWOC, that's not narrative anymore. You know, that's, I make that distinction. I've done it my whole career. Yes, yes. I would say that, what's your name? Oh, maybe you don't want it on here. Just say your name's Sally. So Sally. Oh, that's it? So, I mean, in a living story, you live in your story day to day, and you have a story that you're living out, and then your partners in life have their story, their families, but you don't have an all-encompassing narrative unless you want one. You know, well, your career jacket, you know, that's, oh, this is my resume, this is beginning, middle, end. What is it?
If you're a biologist,
you can
use
that energy. Well, it's not, I mean, in Native American culture, you have beginnings, you know, one turtle came and certain origins, but the stories themselves are not told in completeness. Much is left out. Because if you grow up in a community or tribe, you're learning things from the elders and your parents and mentors all the way along.
Okay,
I blame Tyron.
This is for marketing.
Do you want to come again? Tyron, will you shut up? You are adorable.
Thank you. Ladies, your belt's all snugged up.
Why do we have to buckle up? The pickup stinks with diesel. I gotta be kidding. Stupid question! This is the end! We need resuscitation! Mouth-to-mouth resuscitation! Hurry up! Rappers love the diesel engine because they can listen to their music.
Okay, who gives a crap about the rappers?
Diesel cars are noisy.
It's supposed to be funny. You could laugh.
This one's not noisy at all.
Mine was very noisy, but it was an 82.
Turn it on.
It's on, Mary.
It's on.
It's on.
It's on.
It's on.
No, it's on.
Don't play games. Turn the damn thing
on. It's on, Mary.
So
facade or a facade?
It's a plus sad.
You better start looking for a diesel station, Terry, because they're very hard to find.
You gotta be kidding, Josie. What are we gonna do, be stranded with no food? That's my biggest nightmare, dying on an empty stomach. You know what I'd be missing? Pasta basil, pasta cheese, pasta fazool, pasta lundek.
Josie, press the GPS. There's diesel all over the place.
Look at all my new car. Isn't diesel dirty? Oh, say it's beautiful, for Christ's sake.
I think it's beautiful, but aren't diesels dirty?
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, that used to be dirty. This is 2015.
No. Listen to me, Terry. Diesel in Latin means dirty.
I'll prove it to you.
You're gonna ruin your scarf. Oh, look what she's doing.
See how clean it is?
It's not dirty, but you still have a dirty mind.
I do not.
Yes, you do.
So what are your questions?
You gonna show the John Oliver version?
No, I haven't seen that. What is it?
It has a different type on the same app.
Oh, okay. I would love to see that. I'll go look. Is it up on YouTube?
It'll be there. Yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. I'll find it. That's great. I'll do that next week for next week, so you can come back. So we're gonna talk about the Volkswagen, and I was asked to talk about American corporations. So. They're not totally American, but what happened is in the United States, Volkswagen looked at the market and said, we want to be the biggest car company in the world by 2018. In order to do that, we need to get in the American market with our diesels. In order to do that, we have to pass all the pollution control emission tests that are required to certify the diesels to come into the United States. So this happened about 9 years ago, and let's take it to the next step. Okay, did that. Oh, I pushed the backward arrow, that's right. Okay, now we're just gonna go backward. Or maybe I'm holding it wrong.
Put it towards the audience.
Okay, now we're good. Okay, so, federal prosecutors announced criminal charges eventually against six Volkswagen executives, some of them went to jail, for a cheating scandal. Calls it corporate culture fraud involving hundreds of VW executives, engineers, and managers. That's a disputed narrative because Volkswagen's counter narrative is it was just a couple of design software people. Lowly paid that went out on their own and created these devices. But a total of $25 billion in fines, a buyback of 550,000 diesel cars happened. Now, I'm kind of mechanical, so you can nod off on this part if you want, but anyway, this is what they're talking about. There's a main computer in each car, and it's a module, and it senses the car, whether it's in a lab test or not. Whether it's on the road. And the way it does that is the wheel moves when you're driving, so then it turns off all the pollution controls. When you're in a lab mode, the wheel's not shifting. This is one of the ways that they did it. You have a diesel oxidation catalytic converter, a sensor there, you got temperature sensors, you got another catalytic converter, H2S, you have a muffler, of course, and you have this nitrogen oxide trap. That's the really bad gases that you don't want to get into the atmosphere. It causes smog in cities, for example. You want to reduce the toxic, put too many S's in it. Like that. More fuel for the trap to work, and the computer to save fuel by allowing more pollutants to pass through the exhaust. So if you turn the pollution control off, you're going to get better mileage, but you're going to pollute. Now, it turns out that it wasn't just Volkswagen. Volkswagen has some of these models. They also make Audi, something else up here. But you go down the line and you have BMW, Honda, Mazda, Volvo, Citroen, Toyota, Peugeot, okay, and that are above the pollution limit. And it costs so much pollution, this, all these cheating devices on all these cars, that in metropolitan cities, big cities, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, smog levels started to rise. It affected people's health big time. So VW is a conglomerate, Skoda, Audi, Opel, Porsche, Bentley, etc. 8,000 VW diesels sold in New Zealand. There will be no compensation to Kiwis, is what I read in the paper. Is that correct? Any of you get compensated? Any of you want to admit that you have a diesel VW? No? Okay. I won't put you on the spot. But your ministers have VW limousines, and they're going back and forth whether to get the diesel limousine or the gas-driven limousine. It's hybrid models. Cost $190,000 New Zealand dollars each. They got bulletproof glass. There's a fleet of 36 of them? No? Okay. That's what I'm reading. Let's look at the ethics. The equality principle. The top 1% in black here gone from about a 44 share of wealth up to 55%, and the bottom has moved from having half down to 45%. So those two vectors are crossing. There's something called the purchasing power parity, and this is for Pavel, so wake up now. So I want to start, I know I'm a qualitative researcher, but I've started to critique the numbers because I'm really tired of it, the malarkey that they're telling us about globalization. So if you look at purchasing power parity, the three Ps, the World Bank's narrative. But you know, the World Bank was created by the United States right after World War II and IMF. It's called the Washington Consensus. So whenever you see World Bank, you should think U.S., greedy people. You know? That's my idea. Anyway, life of the poor is improving with globalization and has met, surpassed the first millennium developmental goal to cut 1990 poverty rate in half, moving 1.1 billion people out of extreme poverty. How many people believe that's true? I don't believe it. I'm challenging those numbers. I think, are you challenging them?
I mean, lesser people are dying of starvation today than maybe 100 years ago.
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah, they're all being killed.
But that's not good enough, eh?
By Volkswagens. And then they adjust the poverty line for each particular country. Do you know how that's done? They take a $50 basket, shopping basket, run it through the supermarket in the United States, and this is what we need to live on, right? In the United States. And then they say, oh, but if you're in Haiti or Bangladesh, Central African Republic, you don't need that. You could eat, you know, not that good of fish. You could eat, you know, you don't need toilet paper, you know? You don't need all these things. So you can live on $1.25 a day, or $1.90 a day, or $2 a day. And they keep switching them around. Like 2008 is $1.25, and 2015 is $1.90, you know? And it's the equivalent food basket, you know? I think we need to deconstruct that, so I created my own approach called the margarita glass, where I took and simply divided the world population, 7.6 billion, into five evenly divided, 125 billion in each tier. And then I wanted to look at, okay, how does the top tier live? Let's go to the top of the top tier. 8 billionaires have 50% of $280 trillion. Now, if you're an economist in accounting or something, where's my accountant? She's over there. She's checking my numbers right now to see what the calculator is. Yeah, if I get it wrong, just let me know. And change it, but I did this on a calculator on the computer. I don't know if it's right. So 8 billionaires have 50% of the money, which means they have $48 billion a day to live on. That's a lot of money. It's in their stocks and companies they own and their yachts. But the top 1% own 50.1% of the world's wealth. That's $280 trillion. That means they each have, on average, $367 million, $3.67 million a day. Now we go down here and we're getting more towards the middle class, and that tier has $20 a day. I'm not doing the PPP to help with that, you know? You need more than just food in that basket to live. You need security, you need infrastructure, you know? You need to be able to sleep at night without being raped. You know, these are important things that they're not figuring into the PPP ratios, in my opinion. Then you go down here, these people now, they only have $8, and down here, about $4.38, and the bottom of the bottom, $2. Like, I raised it, you know? I didn't raise it, that's the way the numbers come out. We don't fudge with the PPP. Am I wrong here? Am I doing things with numbers you shouldn't be doing?
Well, the PPP exists for a reason. Like,
To justify United States hegemony.
Not necessarily.
Let's get into it.
When I go to India, $50 will get me a lot of food. It gets me a lot of food. While in New Zealand, it's about half what you need for one person a week.
Okay.
So the PPP exists not to make some countries look better than others, but to show that the cost of living is cheaper in some countries than others. But doesn't take away from the fact that there is one-fifth of the population living on less than $2 a day, which doesn't get you a lot.
I agree with you. Dinner for you.
Dinner?
You have to buy it yourself. Cool. So what?
So PPP exists for a reason, but I don't think ignoring it is a good reason either.
Yeah, it's a bunch of committees that get together. And it's about 200 people on these various statistical committees, and they hash it all out, and they decide what the PPP is for each country.
Do you know what the biggest indicator is in each country?
Tell me.
It's the cost of a Big Mac in every country.
Yeah, I'm going to get to that. Oh, God. You set it up perfectly.
Yeah. Okay. So I get two
days. Let's skip to all this. But this is from Milne and Gray, again, two wonderful scholars. Milne's in New Zealand. GDP is not a measure of anything relevant to ecology. Says. The GDP ranking of nations is ecologically irrelevant. You mentioned the Big Mac score. That's one of the ways we can rank nations. Since they do not account for the possible absolute increase in material flows from the ecosphere to the economy. In other words, they're not really keeping track of the damage they're doing to the natural environment. Mm-hmm. So it's all well and good to just use a GDP ranking. Now I'm looking here at not the two bottom ones. These are the countries I'm going to on my sabbatical. Yay! It's my last sabbatical. I'm 70 years old. I shouldn't even be standing here. No way. So I'm going to go to Denmark, Finland, France, Greece, Italy, New Zealand, United Kingdom, and back to the U.S. You know? The GDP ranks Denmark 34, France number 6, Italy number 8, of course the U.S. is number 1, New Zealand's 51 for the GDP. Now if we look at HPI, that's another ranking system where they got a score, and it's composed of three indices. Because you got to look below the big numerical narrative down at the sub-indices. I think everything is numeric, has a narrative to it, so that's just me. And then you got well-being. How do you think they measure that? Who knows? Okay, your undergrads are smarter than you. They knew. No, they didn't.
Ask people how happy they are when they get grade. Most people answer around 7 anyway.
Yeah. Well, they have a scale. It's a 10-point scale, and they say how happy they are.
Okay. And most people answer 7.
So it's completely bad research, you know? They have one question. They're calling people, how happy you are. Well, they have to have a phone, first of all, to answer. Whatever. And so, yeah, there's not much variance there. And then you got living, and ecological footprint. And I think our footprint is actually bigger than that. And I looked at the highest and the lowest on the HPI index, and it's Costa Rica, but they're being carried along by a very low footprint, even though, you know, maybe not so happy in Paul Swan. Now we'll take a look at, now we got the Human Development Index again, the GDP, Happy Planet Index, Global Peace Index, Big Mac Index. Want you to see something interesting is the price of the Big Mac varies from country to country. Whoopee. You know? And then we have the environmental vulnerability, highly vulnerable, vulnerable, extremely vulnerable, Italy. Extremely vulnerable, United Kingdom. U.S., kind of vulnerable, you know? Environmental performance, et cetera. So now, what I'm gonna just, you don't need to like go dizzy over the numbers. The rankings are different depending on what index you're using, which is what I got out of Pavel's wonderful presentation. At least I hope I got that out of it.
Thank you, Your Honor. I did mention Bhutan's gross happiness index.
Yeah.
That's your idea of a counter-narrative. You don't have to have development, you can be happy.
Bhutan's kind of a special case, though, because you can't use that index anywhere else, although a couple of countries are looking at it, I understand. And the other thing, they've had some genocide going on.
Yeah.
It's big time.
It keeps them happy, because the people they're killing are sad.
They're gone,
so on average,
they're dead, so they can't report.
That's what Bhutan does. I mean, if you're talking about hegemony, then Bhutan's a bad example.
On the plus side, their infant mortality rate has gone down. And, but if you look at the numerical indices, is it over?
I've got a couple of minutes.
Okay, so forget that U.S. companies dominate the global index of the world's most sustainable companies. And in 2018, these are the companies that are considered the most sustainable in the United States. I know some of those companies, I wouldn't stack them up as sustainable. And I'll just talk about the other tour I want to do next year is to Bangladesh, Bhutan, Central Africa, the Congo. And now you see some really different numbers up here on the indices. And there's more on the Happy Planet Index. One of the things that you can do about this to leave you on a somewhat positive note is the, my wife and I are working to end slavery in the United States. You probably thought slavery was over in the United States with Lincoln, but actually, up to about 15 years ago, in agriculture, tomato industry, tomatoes grown in Florida, slaves locked up, chained up, raped, beaten, forced labor, pays, cheating, you know, in the United States. And it turns out with human trafficking all over the world. Now this group I work with, the coalition of Immokalee, Immokalee's a city in Florida, workers, my wife and I are studying how they got corporations to develop actual corporate social responsibility that was monitored by the workers, you know, and not by some podunk accounting firm, no offense to accounting, but just, or some consultancy firm. So this, they're demonstrating now against Wendy's food chain, because Wendy's is still sourcing slave labor tomatoes. So I want you never to eat at Wendy's until they stop sourcing from slave labor. You know, that's my request. And these are the companies that they did get contracts with. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there such a thing as fair trade tomatoes?
Fair trade, yeah. Fair trade program, FTP. Yeah, and they started that. The migrant workers who freed themselves from slavery, who got the Justice Department to prosecute what's called coyotes that run slaves. And look at the companies that they got on board in slavery. Taco Bell was first, Pizza Hut, then McDonald's, then Burger King, then Whole Foods Market, Subway. Some of these you have. I don't think you have these three. These provide food for schools. Trader Joe's is California. Walmart. Don't ever let them in to New Zealand, would be my advice. You know, the supply chains, there's quite a few sweatshops. And then you got Ben and Jerry's. Good ice cream, but they got problems. But they all join Fair Food Program. They'll have monitoring. If the workers report sexual rape violations, pay, etc., then they're kicked out of the program, and they, you know, Walmart can't buy tomatoes from those growers. McDonald's can't buy them. Anyway, that was the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And next week I'll talk about conflict minerals. Okay. More questions? What do you, okay, did I do okay? Are you happy? Mm-hmm. You want to applaud or you just thank you. So I hope my wife likes it. Good.